Just to double check, you are in session for live English speaking presentations for the day. Just a quick rundown of the schedule. This morning we have Jeremiah Day and Annika Kalman. We will take a coffee break at 11:15 for 15 minutes, and then we will meet back for 11:30 for a presentation with Jorge Navarrete and Michelle Janssen. We will then have a lunch break at 1 o'clock. So those of you who attend the Princess Scotland regularly, lunch is at 1 o'clock, not 12 o'clock. And then there will be two film screenings this afternoon, directed by Dora Garcia and Felix Mellon, both of whom are professors at the Academy here at Princess Scotland. A couple of other things I just wanted to point out before we get started. There is a fantastic exhibition in a secluded gallery very close to the canteen. We call it the White Box, but it's not very easy to find. So I'm just letting you know about it. I'm going to hand out a little bit of information because this is an impromptu exhibition, so if you can take one. And the exhibition is actually a BA3 student. We're in a timetable at the moment where the BAs are moving up to apply for their MAs, and Danielle Chudy has initiated a self-directed project in Bali, of all places. I'd like to think that the Princess Scotland has the budget for us all to go to Bali, but unfortunately, it's something she did herself. So that's something to check out over lunch, and she'd be very appreciative of any feedback that you can offer, because it's her first solo exhibition. That's a good reminder if you can turn off your phones and let's have a recording the exhibition. And also, I'm here to moderate for the day, so if anybody has any other announcements I'm unaware of, please come and find me and I'll let everybody else know. My name is Victoria Brown. I'm the Associate Professor of Print and Publishing here at the Princess Scotland. Which I also then get to name drop a colleague of mine, Jan Pettersen, who will be launching his publication this evening, which is in relation to another very ambitious seminar that took place 2 years ago, Printmaking in the Expanded Field. Those of you who might not have any relationship with print per se, this is a great example of how we can publish research to be both relevant to those people working within artistic research, but also to introduce a public audience to what we do. So that will take place in the library this evening at 5 o'clock. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Jeremiah Day and the title of his presentation, The Chair Remains Empty, But the Place is Set. Jeremiah Day graduated from UCLA and later attended the Rijks Academy in Amsterdam. He lives and works in Berlin. He used to teach here at the Academy as a visiting professor. His doctoral work has been conducted in collaboration with the Free University of Amsterdam, and he was supported by the National Research Foundation of the Netherlands to complete the first PhD in art in the Netherlands. So I'd like to welcome you, Jeremiah.
I'm gonna talk about team number one. The Pelham Meeting House in Western Massachusetts, where they've been having town hall meetings as either the primary or secondary form of government for over 200 years. And in many of the early New England colonies, the town hall meeting, the meeting hall was also used as a church. But what they would do is they would only bring the Bible in on Sunday morning and bring it out on Sunday evening. The Bible is not allowed to sleep in the building, so that the priority wouldn't get confused. And Cotton Mather said, who was a theologian, an early New England theologian, he said, well, nowhere in the Bible does it say that a space of public assembly needs to be called a church. Pelham is also where, after the American Revolution, there was an event called Shays' Rebellion. So there was a rebellion by farmers against the centralized authority of Boston, which turned into like a kind of a violent uprising that lasted for a few weeks. Thomas Jefferson was in France when he heard about Shays' Rebellion, and he said, God help us if we are without such rebellions for too long. The tree of liberty needs to be refreshed with the blood of patriots and tyrants. But it's interesting because just past that line there is a huge body of water called the Quabbin Reservoir, which was made in the 1930s by drowning a town. So they told everybody they had to leave, and then they just filled the town with water so that they could then have water supply for the city of Boston. And you can see that if this form of government actually had maintained political power until 1930, it would be impossible to imagine that the city of Boston would be able to come and drown an entire town. This is the middle school. This was a high school in Falmouth, Massachusetts, where my mother and my grandmother, my mother and my aunt and my uncle went. And these kinds of buildings were built after the Second World War in Massachusetts. And they replaced this kind of infrastructure of the town meeting hall and the small town church. And they replaced it with these big buildings which had in them what they called a multifunction room, which was basically the basketball court. And in the basketball court is where they started to have town hall meetings. This is by 1940. This is Tammany Hall in New York. Has anybody ever heard of Tammany Hall? No. So Tammany Hall is the foundation of the American political machine. So it was a combination of like a mafia, real estate, police, Democratic Party, immigrant, social services. And it was a patronage system that would give people jobs for voting for the candidates they told them to vote for. And then they would also, if necessary, violently repress anyone who opposed them and rig elections. And this is the organizational structure of the Democratic Party from the 1840s until today. So in New York, in Brooklyn, in the summer of 2016, 140,000 people went to go vote and found out that they had been stripped from the rolls. Do you know what that means? That means like they would go to vote and find out they were not allowed to vote. Their name wasn't there anymore. Is that clear? So you would show up and then you wouldn't be allowed to vote. It's a town meeting hall in rural Connecticut. The steeple has fallen off, and so they've just put it in front of the building. And there's a big debate in the town whether or not to tear down the building and make like a new restaurant, or whether or not to preserve the building, to restore it. It's Taksim Square in Istanbul. Part of the reason that Taksim is important is because in 1971, they have an annual May Day protest there. In 1971, there were snipers on the top of this building who killed an unknown number of people. And it's still unclear who the snipers were. This building was owned by the IT&T Corporation, International Telegraph and Trade, which my grandfather worked for. And apparently on this day, you couldn't get into the hotel without an American passport, so the Turks have long suspected that it was a CIA operation. Taksim Square has a small park in it called Gezi Park, which was then occupied for a few days, for a few weeks, because the government wanted to build a new real estate development there, which was a kind of a symbolic intervention into the civic political structure of Turkey to replace this modern, this public space associated with the history of Turkish modernity, to replace it with a mosque and shopping mall. So kind of the new Turkish capitalism plus Islam, neoliberalism plus Islam. When the police pushed everyone out of Gezi, the Beşiktaş Football Club announced that Abasaga Park in Beşiktaş was the new Gezi. So people started coming and gathering there at night, and then it spread throughout the whole country. There was this spontaneous neighborhood council, people's assembly, that they called the forums. And it was this question of kind of what to do next. It was a bit different than Gezi. Gezi was an occupation, and there was a sense that the space that they were making there was itself a political space, kind of almost like a commune or something. Maybe more like Occupy, like here, us together, we are this autonomous thing. And the forums were very much about deciding, well, what do we do next? But somebody had to go first. They're going to redevelop all the parks now in Istanbul. Somebody had to show up. I'm here. I'm here. You're here. We are. Yogurtku Park is kind of famous among the forums movement as the women's forum. And when winter came, they squatted a house nearby. I've got things to take care of there, things about which only I know. My stepmother, the wife of my father. She says she cannot handle the anxiety. Of worrying about things that are not in her control. 16 years. 16 years. 16 years. My stepmother, the Alcoholics Anonymous, they have the Serenity Prayer. It's just like, God grant me the courage to deal with the things that are in my control, and the serenity to deal with things that are not in my control, and the wisdom to know the difference. So you shouldn't be anxious about things that are not in your control, that are not in your power. How can you take responsibility for things that are not in your power? Sixteen more, that'll be 20, 34. This is Pendik. It's like the furthest forum that happened in Istanbul, that's still Istanbul. It's about 44 kilometers from Taksim. In Afghanistan. My stepmother, she says she cannot worry about Afghanistan or not. The North Atlantic Treaty Organization, the case in Norway, the promises that were broken to Russia. In Afghanistan, I think they've got a picture of us. I think they've got a picture of us. I think they believed us when we said we were democracy. They've got a picture of me after all I sent them my representative, my representation. Representation, oh, democracy. And I feel they might think that we are responsible. So maybe my stepmother should worry about it. Because if she's not responsible, if there's no responsibility, round here, no, I mean this town here, I mean the facts on the ground round here, I mean the way it goes down round here, I mean who's the boss around here, I mean who calls the shots around here. I mean, who picks the boss? I mean, who picks the kids? This is in Berlin. And then you have to go all the way past Poland to get to Königsberg, which is now like Kaliningrad, where the Russians have now brought these missiles in. But that's where Hannah Arendt was born, and that's actually where Kant lived. That's incredible to think that was Germany. But when Hannah Arendt was a little child, her mother followed the news very closely about what was happening in Berlin. And her mother became a kind of a sympathetic Spartacist. So the Spartacist movement was a moment after the First World War. There was a break between the different parts of the German Communist Party, and Rosa Luxemburg argued that there should be a spontaneous revolution of the people, that the party should not be in charge, that we should trust that the people should form their own revolution. So Hannah Arendt, when she moves to the United States, she discovers this link between councils, the Räterepublik in Germany, and the New England town hall meeting structure. It's a preparatory sketch for a performance. So, last spring, my friend Fred Dewey came here and gave a lecture, and I really learned about all this stuff from Fred Dewey. And Fred Dewey's interesting because he did not see these as theoretical issues, he saw them as actually practical issues. And so he was very involved in starting a structured neighborhood councils in Los Angeles, which is part of Los Angeles city government. But one of the things that Arendt points out is she says, well, why did nobody ever try this town hall meeting system now as a replacement for political parties? Like as a replacement for party democracy, we could have council democracy. And she says part of the reason that nobody ever proposed that is that there isn't a very good memory of these experiences, because the people who even had these experiences didn't really remember them very well afterwards. So she talks about the French resistance fighters who also had a kind of a spontaneous, participatory, horizontal self-government structure, and that as soon as the war ended, as soon as they were, quote, liberated and the Germans left, they went back to parliamentary systems. And she says it's like this little thing that they experienced because what it was so outside of any frame of reference for them that it was impossible to build anything around it. So she says, like, it's possible that a unicorn or a fairy queen, a cloud castle, all of those things might be more real to us than the actual history of revolutions. Because a unicorn, right, is like you take a horse and you take something with an antler or a spear on it and you put it together. Or a centaur, we take a Pearson and we take a horse. So Kant says that memory and imagination are linked. We don't just imagine like spontaneously. Even genius has to do with memory. And so Arendt somehow suggests that memory itself has a political faculty. And so I was interested in somehow trying to sketch together a memory story of this tradition, of this lost tradition. And that's something that I've been working on in different forms, in different places. These are drawings for a series of performances that I made. The main kind of device that I used was I linked, sort of like today, but maybe a bit bigger, was I would link like where I'm from in New England with its strange history of town hall meetings, and then Istanbul, which is a place where I lived before. And one of the big engines for the whole piece was thinking about this advice that a hippie told me once in Cape Cod, that in the town where I'm from, the local bar, McDonald's wanted to take over the local bar, and the hippies like held out and kept McDonald's out, but it took 11 years. And so I said, well, how do you fight for 11 years? And he said, well, everybody gets to take a year off. Everybody gets to take a year or two off. And I thought this was very funny political advice, was that like before you even start, you should imagine that everybody gets to take a year off. So I was trying to explain this to my friend in Turkey, and I said, oh, you know, I'm doing this research project about Hannah Arendt and Gezi and America, and maybe I could come and give a talk about it. And he said, you know, you can't like give a talk like that here now. It just doesn't make sense. This situation is too kind of compressed. It's too heated to like somehow come in and intellectualize about it as an outsider. Also, all of the subjects, I mean, people are losing their jobs. Like political repression is a very real thing there. So it's not like an intellectual subject. So he said, you should write a letter. You should write some kind of text. And then I thought, well, I don't really know how to write so well. So I used that as like the beginning for the performance for a while. So I would make these performances kind of sketching out these ideas about Hannah Arendt and about the history of New England town hall meetings. Maybe I'll just show a minute of the performance. I'll show like the like a minute at the beginning and a minute at the end. Well, let's see if this, I didn't check this out. And then I had to imagine if you would say to these people in Istanbul who I know, like, the idea is everybody should get to take a year off, what would they say back? You know, what would be the response to that? And I had to think that the response would be that, you know, it's time, the year is over, it's time to get back to work. So this is the end of this version. This was November 2016 at the Gallery Ellen de Brown in Amsterdam.
So I was in the air, and then this thing would come back, and I had to think about Mark telling me about this game he plays. He plays this game in the hospital with other guys, and like, how many borders do you have to cross? How many borders do you have to cross to get through here? To a level. And back again. So it's like,
incidentally, we're here for the National Day. And in the midst of the march, somehow we started talking about Tonesberg and the Haugating, which is something I didn't know anything about. But Fred had heard about it from a German, this tradition of the Ting. And so we went out there. Is this something people know about, like, is it obvious way in Scandinavia?
Too few of us.
What?
Too few of us. We've forgotten about it.
So this was the place where they made the Norwegian kings, but more importantly, it's the place where they said to the Swedish king that the right for the king to exist depended upon the people. So the king could not do just what the king wanted. The king's ability to be the king depended upon the people's support of him. And so they forced the king to make peace, to end a war. Fred was trying to explain this image from his teacher who had studied with Hannah Arendt, a guy named H.R. Shapiro. The idea was that the town hall meetings could somehow like grow up like grass through the structure of totalitarianism. They could just emerge out. And there's this image that this other guy, H.R. Shapiro, and Fred really liked from Solzhenitsyn, that Solzhenitsyn would talk about the wall of the lie in the Soviet Union, that it was actually a piece of cloth. And you could just poke a hole right through it. And if you would poke your hole through it, and then another person would go, it would get bigger and bigger, and then all of a sudden everyone would be on the other side of the lie. But of course that's very different than our situation, because that was a unipolar, a single political party producing a complete media, educational, ideological structure. It was one story. Our situation is different. Fred really insisted I take pictures of this, and that there's a Kita there now. So a place where the people would get together and tell the king that the right for the king to exist depends on them. In Norway. It's clear. Thank you. That's the end. Maybe I do have time. questions? Or anybody? Does anybody have any good Ting stories?
Norwegian law in the 13th century said that the king had to follow the law. They have to go to the different, actually not just the Gulatings, but the other ones. And if he broke the law, it was everybody's duty to kill him.
Uh-huh.
So we didn't have the system that was in the rest of Europe.
Uh-huh.
But a couple of years ago when we had, well, 4 years ago, when we had a 200th anniversary, we've forgotten it. We talked about the source of our constitutions being France and America, and we've forgotten that the main inspiration was our own tradition.
Huh.
Because it's been a conspiracy among historians.
Super
There's been a relationship between the tradition of history, which where actually historians in Reykjavik has taken some charge. There was an article in 1911 by a Swede which said that the further away a text is from the event, the less truthful it is, which meant that major sources of our own history was not considered historical sources until the very last few years. And we've only had the major works of our own ancient history published in Norwegian the last few years. So we had a very extraordinary history in the sense that on the one side we've been glorifying our past, and on the other side we haven't actually known about it. It's political side. There's some work to be done there.
Some work to be done.
Yeah. I guess it's worth underlining that the people coming together were free men.
And women who owned property or were widows.
Yeah, who were widows, exactly. But
and
they were quite few.
Well, there was nowhere else in Europe where that was the case.
In Sweden.
Well, Sweden is part of the same culture. I'm talking about the rest of Europe, meaning Britain, Holland, and other nice places.
So, what's the implication of that? You think it's a patriarchal form?
Yes.
Does that make it? How can you affirmatively repossess patriarchal forms today, or no? Are they're off limits?
Absolutely.
So how?
But Maybe you already addressed the councils in Russia, the tradition of the Obshchina in the villages of Russia for hundreds and hundreds of years, and then the early councils that the socialists started forming around 1900, which was sort of the precursor to the revolution.
No, I didn't talk about Russia, I was talking about Rosa Luxemburg before. I think it's super relevant what you're saying, because there's one of the big issues we're dealing with in all politics now is the relationship between these issues of different kinds of, how different kinds of political structure and social justice issues relate or don't relate. So how does it, like if you look at the United States, there's like a huge momentum towards dealing with certain kind of social justice issues, but at the same time the political structure issues somehow keep going the same. So how do you bring those two things together, like hashtag me too Ting? I don't know how to do that.
Well, it's super interesting to look at historical examples.
Yeah.
And there are quite a number when you start looking at it also beyond Europe.
Well, I think the idea of looking at the local is there's a strategy, which is maybe a questionable strategy, but the strategy would be that by accessing the thing that is actually here, there would be more leverage with that than accessing something that would be from so far away, because that would be more of a kind of a concept than like a trace. Even if the trace is, there is no trace, there is a sense of like, it's 20 minutes away, you know? So, there's not a trace, but there is a kind of a material, the worldliness of it is very self-evident. So I think that's one of the strategies to deal with all these things through exemplification and sight. It's like as if that somehow poetically might open up access in a different way, but it's a highly aestheticized approach in a way. But so, the tank and, but what, so what do you, I don't understand, what do you think about it then? If that the tank was mostly property holding men?
Well,
free men.
It means serfs existed until the late Middle Ages.
Okay. So non-serfs, women of property. So it was not really egalitarian. It was about freedom but not equality. I'm sorry, I cut you off.
No, sure. It, we have developed. But we did have a tradition of, there were systems of freeing slaves. I mean, yes, you had serfs and you also had bonds people. There were different categories, of course, changing through history. But we didn't have slavery quite the way that you guys perfected it too.
We all have to have our claims to fame. Yeah, great. Thank you so much.